Okay, Michael, what's the answer?
Does he have spleenitis?
Yes, does he have spleenitis?
I don't think we know for sure.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, it's a noisy and probabilistic world, right? So the test told us that things look like he has spleenitis, and the test is usually right, but the test is sometimes wrong, and it can give the wrong answer, and that's really all we know, so we can't be sure.
Okay, but if you had to pick one, if you had to pick yes or no, like our students did when they took the quiz, which one would you pick, yes or no?
So I guess seat of the pants, I would just say yes because the test says yes. But if I guess I was trying to be more precise, I might go through and work out the probability. And I guess if it's more likely to have than not to have, then I'd say yes, and otherwise I'd say no.
Okay, so how would you go about doing that? Walk me through it.
Based on the name of the quiz, I think I'd go with Bayes' rule.
Okay, so I like that. So Bayes' rule, as everyone will recall, is the probability of the hypothesis given the data is equal to the probability of the data given the hypothesis times the probability of the hypothesis divided by the probability of the data. So let's write all that out. So what is the probability of spleenitis, which I'm just going to write as an S,
And we're
given?
making jokes about spleenitis, but we don't want that to be confused with splenitis, which is a real thing and probably not very pleasant. So apologies to anyone out there with splenitis, but this is spleenitis, which is really totally different.
Is splenitis a real thing?
Yeah.
Really, what is it?
Enlargement and inflammation of the spleen and the spleen as a result of infection or possibly a parasite infestation or cysts.
So what you're saying is that's gross and we don't want to think about it. Okay, good. Okay. So, okay, so the probability of getting spleenitis,
Spleenitis.
which again is a very rare thing and probably isn't even real.
Totally, it's totally different. It's definitely not real.
Yeah, totally not. Given that we've gotten a positive result. And you said we should use Bayes' rule. So that would be, in this case, what?
So it's the same as the probability of the positive result given that you have spleenitis times the prior probability of having spleenitis. And I want to say normalized, but like divided by the probability of a positive test result.
And what would be the probability? The other option is that you don't have spleenitis, even though you got a positive result. And that would be equal to.
The probability of a positive result given that you don't have spleenitis times the prior probability of not having spleenitis divided by the, again, the same thing, the probability of the test result. So that's those two things added together need to be one.
Right. But as you point out, if we just want to figure out which one is bigger than the other, we don't actually have to know this.
Good point.
So we can ignore it. Okay. So let's compute this. So what is, in fact, the probability of me getting a plus given that I have splenitis?
All right, so it says in the setup, the test results correct positive 98% of the time. So I think that's what it means. I think it means that if you really do have it, it's going to say that you have it with that probability.
Okay, so that's just 0.98. Okay, and that's times the prior
0.008.
probability of having spleenitis, which is
0.008.
right, 0.008. And what's that equal to? It is equal to 0.0078.
0.00784.
Okay, fine. We can do the same thing over here. So what's the probability of getting a positive if you don't have spleenitis?
So the probability of a correct negative is 97%. That means if you really don't have it, it's going to say you don't have it. So probability of positive result given that you don't have it, that should be the 3%.
That's exactly right. Times the prior probability of not having spleenitis, which is
0.992, 1 minus 0.008.
That's right. And that is equal to
0.02976.
so which number is bigger?
The one that has the larger significant digit.
Which one of those two is that?
I mean, obviously the one that's bigger is the don't you don't have it.
That's right. So the answer would be no.
And in fact, the probability is almost 80%,
Yeah.
which is crazy. So it's like you go into the doctor, you run a test, the doctor says, "Congratulations, you don't have spleenitis," because the test says you do.
That's right. So what does
That
that tell
seems
you?
stupid.
That does seem stupid, but what does it tell you about Bayes' rule? What is Bayes' rule capturing? What is the thing that makes the answer no, despite the fact you have a high reliability test that says yes?
I guess the way to think about it is a random person showing up in the doctor's office is very unlikely to have this particular disease. And even the tiny little small percentage probability that the test would give a wrong answer is completely swamped by the fact that you probably don't have the disease. But I guess this isn't really factoring in the idea that, you know, presumably this lab test was run for some other reason. There was some other evidence that there was concern.
Or the doctor just really wanted some more money because she needs a new boat.
Yeah. I know a lot of doctors.
I do too.
Most of them don't work like that.
Yeah, most of them have PhDs, not MDs. So another way of summarizing what you just said, Michael, I think, is that priors matter.
I want to say the thing that I got out of this is tests don't matter.
Well,
like,
tests
what's
matter.
The purpose of running a test if it's going to come back and say, well, it used to be that I was pretty sure you didn't have it, and now I'm still pretty sure you don't have it?
Well, the point of running a test is you run a test when you have a reason to believe that the test might be useful. So if what is the one thing, if I could only change one thing without getting completely ridiculous, what's the easiest thing for me to change about this setup? I have three numbers here, this one, and this one. What would be the easiest number to change?
Well, in some sense, none of them seem that easy to change. But I guess maybe what you're trying to get me to say is that if we look at a different population of people, then we can change that 0.008 number to something else. Like if we only give the test to people who have other signs of splenitis, then it'll probably be a much bigger number.
Right. So changing the test, making the test better might be hard. Presumably, you know, billions of dollars of research has gone into that. But if you don't give the test to people who you don't have any reason to believe have splenitis just walking off the street, as you put it, a random person walking off the street, then you can change the prior. So some other evidence that you might have splenitis would lead the prior to change, and then the test would suddenly be useful. So this, by the way, is an argument for why you don't want to just require that everyone take tests for certain things. Because if the prior probability is low, then the test isn't very useful. On the other hand, as soon as you have any reason to believe or you have strong evidence that someone might have some condition, then it makes sense to test them for it.
Because so it's like a stop and frisk situation.
It's exactly like a stop and frisk situation. I'm looking at you, Mayor Bloomberg. Okay.
But it's, in some sense, your use of the word prior is a little confusing there. So it's not that we're changing the prior, right? It's that we have some additional evidence that we can factor in. And I guess we can imagine that that's part of the prior, but it seems like it's a posterior.
Yeah, it does. One way to think about it was, I think you captured it in what you just said, right? Which is, you can think of it as a prior. Well, prior to what? So it's your prior belief over a set of hypotheses, given the world that you happen to be in. If you're in a world where random people walk in to take a test for splenitis, then there's a low prior probability that they have it. If you're in a world where the only people who come in are people who are from a population where the prior probability is significantly higher, then you would have a different prior. It's really a question about where you are in the process when you actually formulate your question.
So would it be worth asking people how likely would it have to be that you have splenitis to make this test at all useful? Right, that would change a positive result would actually change your mind about whether someone has it.
I think that's something that I'll leave for the interested reader. Where would that prior probability have to change so that getting a positive result, I would be more likely to believe that you actually have it than not? That does bring up a philosophical question though, which is, so what? Just because the priors have changed doesn't mean that suddenly the test is useful, or that the test is going to give you an answer that somehow distinguishes and is dispositive. But from a mathematical point of view, the question of whether this number is 0.008 or 0.8, you know, 0.8%, where does it change? Does it change at 5%? Or does it change at 50%? Or does it change at 500%? It probably changes at 500%. You know, where's the place in which suddenly a positive result would make you believe that they actually had splenitis or whatever disease you're looking for? Okay?
Okay.